the era when water was safer than Earth. The Lopingian, the last era of the Permian period, was a fascinating and terrifying time in Earth's history. Spanning from 259 million years ago to 252 million years ago. This period marked the end of an era before the most devastating biological catastrophe ever recorded, the Permian-Triassic mass extinction. During this time, the Earth was profoundly transformed. The continents were united in the immense supercontinent Pangaea and surrounded by the vast superocean Panthalassa. Extreme contrast marked the dynamics of land and marine life. Curiously, unlike any other time in history, during this brief period, the water was much safer than the Earth, because while the water had few dangerous creatures, the Earth's surface was full of deadly animals and lethal predators, much deadlier than dinosaurs. In the Lopingian, the Moon was closer to Earth, causing unique effects. Due to a faster planetary rotation, days lasted just 22 hours, while colossal tides shaped coastal landscapes and ecosystems unpredictably. These conditions, combined with an arid climate and extreme temperatures, made surviving a challenge even for creatures adapted to those times. The Earth's surface was perilous, and the creatures that roamed Pangaea, such as gorgonopsids and other snapsid predators, were highly deadly. These animals dominated terrestrial ecosystems with their giant teeth and exceptional hunting skills. Their constant presence made any attempt to survive on dry land suicidal. On the other hand, the Lopingian oceans offered a relative haven. Although creatures such as the helicorpion and primitive sharks patrolled the waters, they were significantly less dangerous and far less abundant than terrestrial predators. Compared to Earth, water was a sanctuary. This balance of dangers and refugees defines the Lopingian as an era as extraordinary as it is hostile, which left an indelible mark on the planet's history. The Lopingian did not emerge in isolation. It resulted from a long history of geological and biological transformations that culminated in a fascinating and hostile world. Before this period, the Guadalupean era, approximately 272 to 259 million years ago, had witnessed a warm and humid climate, allowing for a relatively wide proliferation of life on land and in the oceans. However, towards the end of the Guadalupean, a catastrophic event known as the Catastrophe extinction wiped out many marine and terrestrial species, leaving ecosystems fragmented and vulnerable. This event set the stage for the emergence of a much more dangerous world. With the onset of the Lopingian, the Earth entered a period of extremes. The configuration of the continents and the supercontinent Pangaea, and it's bordered by the vast Panthalassa, transformed weather patterns, creating arid and desert areas in much of the continental interior. For any human who had tried to survive in this era, the Earth's surface would have been unforgiving. A harsh climate, no shelters, and an abundance of deadly predators. The low density of predators and the absence of genuinely colossal species made the sea much less hostile than the land surface. While the oceans offered relative tranquility, the land was where any misstep could lead to a lethal encounter. The contrast between terrestrial insecurity and relative sea calm uniquely defines the geological and biological context of the Lopingian. During the Lopingian era, the configuration of the continents and oceans radically differed from what we know today. The entire landmass was united in an immense supercontinent called Pangaea, a colossal land expanse stretching from the poles to the equator. This supercontinent was surrounded by the vast Panthalassa superocean, which covered most of the planet. Panthalassa was more significant than today's Pacific Ocean, and its depths and currents dominated global climatic and ecological cycles. The Tethys Sea was a minor but crucial body of water within Pangaea. It separated the eastern and western masses of the continent and was home to unique marine biodiversity. The arrangement of Pangaea created weather extremes. The coastal regions exposed to Panthalassa and Tethys had relatively stable marine ecosystems. However, the interior of the supercontinent was a vast desert where life faced enormous challenges. This hostile environment would have been hazardous for humans due to the lack of resources, extreme temperatures, and the constant threat of lethal terrestrial predators. In terms of location, what we know today as North America, the USA, was located in the western region of Pangaea, bordered by the Panthalassa and close to the Paleotethys. China and Japan, on the other hand, were located on the eastern margin of Pangaea, influenced by the Tethys Sea. These regions were very different from their modern appearance, but they all shared one common trait: the ubiquitous threat of terrestrial predators. Water, a refuge in the middle of hell. The marine fauna of the Lopingian presented a fascinating but relatively safe ecosystem compared to the horrors that lurked on land. During this period, the oceans were recovering from the devastating effects of the Catastrophe extinction, which occurred 2 million years earlier and decimated many marine species. This left an aquatic world with a reduced density of predators and limited biodiversity, making the sea a relatively tranquil refuge in a time of extremes. Among the creatures that dominated the Lopingian oceans, species such as the Helicoprion, a primitive shark recognized for its strange spiral teeth in the lower jaw, stand out. This unique mechanism made it a skilled crusher of small prey, but its size and behavior classified it as less dangerous to larger creatures. The Hybodonites and the Hasidius were also ancestral sharks that patrolled the waters. However, they lacked the lethality of their modern descendants, mainly due to their small size, which made them dangerous to small fish, but harmless to medium-sized creatures such as humans. In addition to fish, the oceans were home to giant arthropods such as sea scorpions. These creatures looked like something out of a nightmare, but their population was already scarce due to previous extinction events. While impressive, these creatures did not pose a significant danger due to their small numbers and specialized behavior, which only posed a danger to small animals. The low density of predators and the lack of giant marine species made the oceans surprisingly safe. For any human living in this era, the water would have been an ideal refuge compared to the Earth's surface, which was dominated by ferocious predators such as the Gorgonopsids. While marine fauna's evolutionary design was impressive, it did not reach the levels of lethality and brutality that define Lopingian terrestrial ecosystems. In this sense, water offered a respite amid a world of threats. Deadly wildlife on the surface. Before the Lopingian, dinosaurs dominated terrestrial ecosystems. This group of synapsids, distant relatives of mammals, was characterized by robust bodies and thick skulls that gave them impressive attack and defense capabilities. They were first discovered in the 1860s with fossils found in South Africa and Russia, where Permian ecosystems have been extensively studied. These animals, such as the Titanosuchus, could be several meters long and possess strong jaws designed for hunting and defending themselves from other predators. However, their reign ended abruptly due to climatic and ecological events related to the Catastrophe extinction. This extinction wiped out the dinosaurs, leaving a gap in the food chain that was quickly filled by new, much more specialized and dangerous groups of predators, the Gorgonopsids. After the disappearance of the dinosaurs, the Gorgonopsids emerged as the supreme predators of the Lopingian. This group of synopsids, whose name means Gorgon face, was known for its impressive arsenal of hunting adaptations. They were first discovered in South Africa in the early 20th century, thanks to the work of paleontologists such as Robert Broome, who identified their crucial role in Permian ecosystems. Gorgonopsids superficially resemble modern big cats and are often compared to saber-toothed tigers. However, their origin lies in synapsids, a lineage that eventually gave rise to mammals. Their bodies were designed for speed and strength, and their strong limbs allowed them to chase and kill their prey efficiently. One of the most impressive Gorgonopsids was Inostransevia, which could reach 4 meters in length. Paleontologist Vladimir Amelitsky discovered this predator in Russia at the beginning of the 20th century. It possessed canine teeth over 15 centimeters long, designed to pierce and tear flesh. Their hunting style consisted of ambushing large herbivores such as Lystrosaurus and quickly finishing them off, thanks to their jaw strength and ability to inflict fatal wounds. The success of the Gorgonopsids lay in their ability to combine strength, speed, and strategy. Unlike the Dinosaurians, who depended on their size and endurance, the Gorgonopsids were more agile and specialized, allowing them to dominate the Lopingian terrestrial ecosystems completely. Other deadly predators. Although Gorgonopsids were the top predators, they were not alone in the food chain. The Rubiginae, a subgroup of the Therophalians, also played a crucial role in terrestrial ecosystems. These predators, named after finds in the Rubidge region of South Africa, were known for their serrated teeth, which made them particularly deadly. The serrated teeth of Rubiginae allowed them to cut flesh easily, causing deep wounds that quickly weakened their prey. Some paleontologists have suggested that their ability to inflict damage was equal to or even superior to that of Gorgonopsids. In addition, these animals displayed opportunistic behavior, hunting large herbivores and smaller prey. The combination of predatory characteristics in Gorgonopsids and other groups such as Rubiginae made life on the Earth's surface extremely dangerous. Unlike marine ecosystems where predators had been decimated by extinction events, the terrestrial ecosystems of the Lopingian quickly recovered, giving rise to a lethal and well-adapted fauna. Another group of deadly animals, the Therophalian, breastheads, is one of the most fascinating and deadly lineages of the Lopingian. Synapsids, distant relatives of mammals, dominated terrestrial ecosystems alongside Gorgonopsids and other predators. Their diversity and specialization allowed them to occupy different ecological niches, and they stood out for their lethal adaptations such as venomous bites and powerful jaws. Ichabengops and Euchembercia are notable examples of small Therophalians that developed a rare adaptation in the animal kingdom, the ability to inject venom. Ichabengops, discovered in Zambia in 2015, measured less than a meter in length. This predator possessed a skull adapted to store venom glands, which allowed it to paralyze its prey before devouring them. On the other hand, Euchembercia, found in South Africa in the 20th century, also had specialized glands and grooves in its teeth, making injecting venom into its prey easier. Both animals share this ability with the Icetodochuridus, another group of small Therophalians, evidencing an evolutionary trend in the development of chemical weapons at this time in history. The Moschurinus, a much larger Therophalian, could reach up to 3 meters long. This predator, discovered in South Africa, had powerful jaws designed to break bones and dismember large prey. Its biting force was comparable to that of modern big cats, making it one of the top predators of its time. On the other hand, the Megawatsia, although less known, was a large predator that probably combined strength and venom. Fossils had been found that suggest this animal possessed characteristics similar to those of its smaller venomous relatives, raising the possibility that this gigantic predator had a unique ability, that of injecting venom into a larger prey, weakening them before taking them down. If this hypothesis is correct, the Megawatsia would have been the most formidable predators of the era, because if its powerful bite didn't kill you, its venom would. As if that were not enough, Artiosaurus roscius and Chronosochia occupied ecological niches similar to modern crocodiles and alligators in the Lopingian ecosystems. Artiosaurus roscius, discovered in Russia, was a robust reptile that could ambush its prey in aquatic or wet areas. Its body design allowed it to move on land and water, which gave it an advantage in different habitats. Chronosuchia, on the other hand, were giant amphibians that also hunted by prowl. Their elongated skull and jaws full of sharp teeth made them efficient predators, especially in aquatic ecosystems where they could ambush smaller animals that came over to drink water. Within the Rhine Suchad, the Uranocentrodon stands out. This species of giant salamander could measure more than a meter. This aquatic predator lived in rivers and lakes, where it would ambush any animal that came close to drink. With a muscular body and teeth adapted to catch and hold prey, the Uranocentrodon was one of the foremost hunters in the Lopingian freshwater. The Archegosontridae also played an essential role in the aquatic ecosystems of the Lopingian. These ancient alligator-like amphibians were opportunistic hunters who inhabited freshwater bodies. Their semi-aquatic lifestyle and varied diet made them key players in the ecological balance of their time. Herbivores struggling to survive. Although deadly predators dominated terrestrial ecosystems, some herbivores managed to thrive thanks to unique adaptations. Lystrosaurus, a synapsid about 2 meters long, was one of the most successful herbivores in the Lopingian. Its strong limbs and broad snout allowed it to dig deep burrows, where it took refuge from predators. These burrows also offered protection from extreme weather conditions, significantly increasing their chances of survival. Another survivor was the Periosaurus, an armored herbivore that could reach 3 meters in length. Its body was covered in bony plates that protected it from attacks by predators, such as gorgonopsids. Within this group, Scutosaurus carpinski is particularly notable for its size and highly developed defense system. These creatures, although slow, were virtually invulnerable to attacks by small or medium-sized predators. Perhaps a consolation is that in the Lopingian, the skies were dominated mainly by giant insects such as dragonflies rather than large predators. Although these insects could be impressive in size, they did not pose a significant danger to land animals. The absence of larger flying predators meant that herbivores and small terrestrial predators did not have to worry about aerial threats. An unforgiving world. Life was a constant struggle for survival for any creature living on the Lopingian's land surface. Potential prey like the Lystrosaurus and other herbivores faced strong and incredibly efficient predators. In this context, Earth offered no safe havens, and any misstep could result in a fatal encounter. In contrast, while impressive creatures such as the Heliocoprian inhabited the oceans, they were considerably less dangerous. The lack of giant predators and the reduced density of lethal marine species made the water a refuge. This marked a unique contrast in the history of life on Earth. While the oceans were relatively calm, the Earth's surface was plagued by deadly threats, making it inhospitable. The Great Dying, the end of the Lopingian era. The Great Dying, also known as the Permian-Triassic PT mass extinction, marked the end of the Lopingian era and irreversibly transformed the history of life on Earth. This catastrophic event occurred approximately 252 million years ago and is considered the most devastating mass extinction in history, surpassing even the one that wiped out the dinosaurs millions of years later. Its impact was global, affecting terrestrial and marine ecosystems and causing most species to disappear. Several interrelated factors drove the Great Dying, spearheaded by massive volcanic eruptions in the Siberian Traps in present-day northern Russia. Over hundreds of thousands of years, these eruptions released vast amounts of carbon dioxide and methane into the atmosphere, causing extreme global warming that radically altered the Earth's climate. In addition, the increase in greenhouse gases caused by ocean acidification, severely affecting organisms with calcium carbonate shells such as corals and mollusks. Ocean circulation was also disrupted, creating anoxic, oxygen-depleted zones on the seafloor, devastating populations of fish and other organisms dependent on an oxygenated environment. Added to this was the release of methane hydrates from permafrost and the seabed, amplifying the greenhouse effect in a vicious circle that led to the collapse of ecosystems. The impact on marine ecosystems. The oceans, which until then had been a haven for many species, became an inhospitable environment. About 96% of marine species are estimated to have disappeared during this event. Among the most affected were marine invertebrates such as corals, brachiopods, and trilobites were practically exterminated. reef ecosystems which collapse due to acidification and lack of oxygen. Marine predators such as heliocoprian and other cartilaginous fish disappear almost completely. Instead of the more complex organisms, anaerobic bacteria proliferated in the anoxic zones, releasing toxic hydrogen sulfide that worsened environmental conditions in the water and the atmosphere. On land, the effects were equally devastating. An estimated 70% of terrestrial species disappeared, leading to widespread ecosystem collapse. Among the most notorious affected were the gorgonopsids, the main predators of the Lopingian, which became entirely extinct. Other groups, such as the Therisphalians, suffered significant losses, although some minor lineages managed to survive. Large herbivores such as Scutosaurus carpinski and other armored Parasaurus disappeared. The disappearance of the great forests of the Permian transformed the terrestrial landscapes into arid and desolate expanses. Without abundant vegetation, food chains collapsed, affecting all life dependent on those ecosystems. The Great Dying wiped out most of life on Earth, leaving an ecological void that would take millions of years to fill. However, some groups managed to survive, adapting to the extreme conditions. Among them, Lystrosaurus was one of the few herbivores that thrived after extinction. Its burrowing ability and flexible diet allowed them to survive in a hostile world. Bivalves and other small fish managed to resist in the oceans, laying the groundwork for marine diversification in the Triassic period. On land, the first archosaurs began to diversify, laying the groundwork for the dinosaurs' eventual dominance. A transformed world. Ecosystem recovery after the Great Dying was slow and arduous. It took between 5 and 10 million years for biodiversity to reach levels similar to those before the extinction. During this time, the planet underwent a series of transformations that laid the groundwork for a new era in human history. The Great Dying marked the end of the Lopingian and the beginning of the Triassic period, leaving an indelible mark on Earth's evolution. It reminded us of the fragility of ecosystems in the face of extreme environmental changes. It was a testament to the power of life to adapt and re-emerge even in the most adverse conditions. While devastating, this event also triggered the emergence of new life forms that would redefine evolutionary history. During this period, the oceans acidified and warmed, exterminating many forms of life. However, the water would still be a safer place than the surface because the ocean temperatures were higher. They were not enough to kill you, instead something similar to the temperature of a jacuzzi. So even during the apocalypse, you'd rather stay in the water than venture onto Earth to face saber-toothed, venomous, biting predators. Now we want your opinion. Please tell us, if you're in the Lopingian era, would you stay in the water or gamble on the surface? Let us know what you think in the comments.